Now, the decision by Great Britain to leave the European Union was driven partly by xenophobia, partly by paranoia, and a great deal of misinformation. Now, if all that sounds familiar, it's because those are the same three traits shared by Donald Trump's supporters. And joining me now to talk about the parallels between Trump and the Brexit voters is Howard Nations. So, Howard, Donald Trump obviously has some phenomenally Donald Trump-like things to say about Brexit. But before we even get into what Trump thinks about the world, take a minute and just explain, what really happened? What exactly did Britain leave? And why did they even make that decision?
Well, the European Union is a coalition of 28 countries that forms a single market. They have standardized laws for three basic things: free movement of goods, free services between all these 28 countries, and movement of capital between these 28 countries. You don't have to have a passport to move back and forth between these countries. So it's free flow for immigrants moving from country to country to get jobs. They have common policies on trade. And it's a big deal because the European Union is 24% of the global gross domestic product. And one of the main things that the European Union has done is it stopped the British and the French and the Germans and the Italians from fighting with each other the way they've been doing for centuries. And in 2012, they actually received the Nobel Peace Prize because they've worked these 28 countries who fought for centuries into one nice economic and social coalition. Well, along comes Brexit. Brexit means the British exit from the European Union. And Brexit, which people probably don't realize, is a non-binding referendum. But it was passed in June by the UK voters, 52-48, when they voted to leave the Union and just go back on their own and pull out of that European Union. And they voted with 72% of the registered voters participated. And it voted along lines that won't surprise you, the same lines we'd have here in the United States, where the large cities voted to remain in the Union, the small towns voted to leave. And the reason we care about it is it has huge financial implications, but also there's so many similarities between the U.S. and Britain on these issues that it could be a preview of coming attractions in the U.S. for the November presidential election.
And it is interesting. I mean, hey, it'd be great if we could get 72% voter participation.
Boy, wouldn't it?
In the United States. People would feel like we actually had a representative democracy at that point. But those similarities, I think that's what Americans really have to pay attention to. Yeah. Because the same things that the British people were upset about, we see them here in the United States almost to a larger extent. And that has given rise to a guy like Donald Trump, because he comes in and he says, okay, well, here's your problem. But more importantly, here's who is to blame for that. And that played a huge role in this Brexit vote.
Yep. Here's the problem. Here's the solution. And here's who's causing all this. And here's how we're going to handle it. In the United Kingdom, They talk about these problems. They have wealth disparity. They have widespread poverty, particularly among children. You've had a flatline income of workers for decades now. Globalization, obviously, the digital age has reached there, which created a new paradigm for jobs. Jobs are easily transferred, and there they're easily transferred out of Britain into these other 28 countries because they have this flow, agreed flow of business back and forth. So in Britain, there's no relief in sight for the middle class, so much the same as there is for America. So the problems are the same. And along comes Boris Johnson, who is the British Donald Trump. Look, just take a minute and look up Boris Johnson on Google. And he even looks like Donald Trump. They have the same barber. I mean, it's amazing. But he led the charge to leave the European Union. And his arguments, see if any of this sounds familiar. His arguments were, we're going to take our country back. We've got to stop immigration into Britain. We're going to spend the European Union money that we pay into the Union. We're going to spend that on social services for the poor. We're going to create millions of jobs for Brits. We're going to close the border. We're going to get out of bad trade agreements. Any of that? You heard any of that before? Seriously, the parallels are astonishing.
That really is remarkable. It's like he took speeches that Donald Trump has been making for the last year and said, you know what? I can use this to sell my horrible product to the same people. And to be honest, it really does resonate with people who look at their, you know, their lot in life, you know, held down by a system that's, you know, probably just as corrupt as it is here in the United States. And you do, as a person, you want somebody to blame, you know, and they capitalize on that. They see it. They manipulate the voters and they tell them, you know what? Things wouldn't be so bad if we just did X. That's what Donald Trump is doing. That's why he's won the Republican primary. And so it happened over there. But I think one of the more hilarious things about Donald Trump is that he doesn't fully understand consequences. I mean, this is a man who's never had to deal with consequences. And when he does, he turns them into a prophet. So his response to this Brexit is one of the most insulting things I think he's ever done. Certainly most insulting thing he's ever done overseas.
It is. And that's saying a lot. You got so much to choose from. But you know, if you follow through with that, look, he has made so many promises he can't keep. Boris Johnson did the same thing. It's identical. They promised to strengthen the economy in Britain. They promised to create jobs, to increase social services. They leveled the playing field on income inequality. They promised to reduce government bureaucracy, to reduce the government regulation, to have smaller government. Any of that sound familiar? It's exactly the same as the Republicans promised in the United States. So what happens with it? Well, they had the vote. David Cameron, who was the prime minister, had led the Remain group, the people that wanted to remain in the union. Polls favored Remain. Cameron warned of economic consequences. Obama even went to London and gave a speech where he said, London is the economic leader of Europe. They're the number two economic financial center of the world. But England's going to move to the back of the list in the future if you pass this vote. They underestimated them, and they voted. They lost the vote. The day after the vote, Cameron announced his resignation. The markets crashed, and there was $2.1 trillion. That's with a T. $2.1 trillion in wealth was lost in one day on the worldwide markets. The voters were in shock, and it was sad. The next day after the election, when they saw the results, Google almost blew up with the question, what is Brexit? All these people who just voted decided, gee, I wonder what I voted on. So what you're talking about then, it leads us to Donald Trump. What happened to be on the same day he happened to be in Scotland opening his golf course, or reopening his golf course over there. He had been asked earlier about what Brexit was. He didn't know, and they had to explain it to him. But in England, in Scotland that morning, Donald Trump congratulated the Scottish voters for taking their country back. He tweeted that everybody was excited there because they were taking their country back. Twitter absolutely exploded. You need to go read the insults. We can't talk about them here. But read the insults that were aimed at Trump by the Scots. It absolutely exploded with insults because he's congratulating them on taking their country back. Scotland had voted 62% in all 32 of their counties or political subdivisions to remain in the EU. So they just excoriated Trump on Twitter. But as always, what Trump said, it was all about him. He said, well, with the pound dropping, more people can afford to use my golf course. Later he said, listen to this one. This man wants to be the number one man in the world economy. He said, well, this is a British problem. It's not an American problem. This doesn't affect America. And as usual, his opinions are not influenced one way or the other by facts. Because of the $2.1 trillion that was lost in one day, $1.3 trillion of it came out of the U.S. markets. We have the biggest economy in the world, so we had the biggest impact. And that's how much Donald Trump knows about the economy, understands about international monetary affairs. It's sad.
It's terrifying, really, to think that, you know, Donald Trump is a man. Look, he's got about a 50-50 chance of being the next president. It's either going to be Trump or not going to be Trump. You know, kind of same thing with Hillary Clinton at this point. But when we look at just economic policy here, I mean, Donald Trump is so clueless, so just selfish that he doesn't even understand it. Brexit is good because it helps people go play golf and put, you know, $20, $30 at a time in his pocket. I mean, you can't get any more selfish than that. And you can't get any more stupid than that when he's talking to people who voted to stay, congratulating them on leaving. I mean, again, God, this is a man that is very close to becoming president. And we have to take this seriously because he's doing what Boris Johnson did in Britain. He's doing that in America.
And saying that it had no effect on the American economy when we were the biggest loser in the world over this Brexit vote. Well, if we look at what happened, we need to take this. This is a foreboding tale. The British economy plunged, and immediately the corporations, especially the financial institutions, set into play alternative plans they had to move to exodus from London and to move to Frankfurt. The financial institutions that employ more than 2 million people in Britain began moving to Germany immediately, especially to Frankfurt, but to other places in Europe, other European countries. J.P. Morgan CEO Jamie Dimon said that he's moving thousands of financial jobs out of England because they've lost access to the EU. Manufacturers have lost unfettered access to the European Union. It's a business catastrophe. Now, for political leaders, let's see what happens to the guy who led the thing. Boris Johnson, the Donald Trump of England, who was the presumptive choice for prime minister, withdrew from the race. Johnson and Farage, who's the conservative leaders of Brexit, both quit. As one of the members of the House of Lords said, they led their troops to battle and abandoned them as soon as the shooting began. But the promises that they didn't keep, the same promises the Republicans are making here, the promises they didn't keep. Jobs were lost, the economy was severely damaged, employers who have no money now are certainly not going to be increasing benefits for employees. Immigration will slow down, aren't going to be any jobs there for them to seek anyway, and there's no more money for social services, there's actually less. So politically, and then there's another irony, and this may just see if this parallels America. Cameron, when he resigned as prime minister this week, actually, was replaced by a conservative woman, Theresa May, who's the second woman to lead Britain in its history. She had voted to remain because nobody from the Leave leadership survived. So May has already said she's going to appoint at least half of her cabinet positions will be filled by women. So she appointed Boris Johnson as the foreign secretary. So the class clown is now the Secretary of State of England, which is going to be a very interesting dynamic in D.C. because Johnson has called President Obama a Kenyan with an anti-colonial attitude. This is the new chief diplomat to the world of Her Majesty.
Again, it sounds like a talking point that he probably ripped off from Donald Trump. And again, these two men look like they were separated at birth. I mean, it is remarkable. Not only are they saying the same things, they look like the same person.
Yep. And brother from another mother. Yeah. They have the same appeal, same irresponsible comments, same lack of knowledge of the economy and foreign affairs. And they're appealing to the same electorate. And exactly the way it is there, just exactly the way they could not keep the promises in England, Trump, there's no way Trump could keep the promises he's making here. You know, there's a great foreboding tale that comes from Winston Churchill, who wisely said, "Those who ignore the mistakes of the past are doomed to repeat them." And that warning applies to recent past as well as ancient history. Now, what America has witnessed a series of major political mistakes in Britain over the past month, which have led to disastrous worldwide economic and social consequences. The question is, in the November 2016 election, will we learn from our British cousins, or do we have to endure firsthand the economic and social disaster that would flow from the election of Donald Trump as President of the United States? So stay tuned.
Yeah. And I know there's a lot of Bernie Sanders supporters who say, you know, there's no difference between Trump and Clinton. Trust me, look at Britain. There is a big difference. You know, you may not agree with Hillary Clinton on a lot of things, but trust me, nobody could be worse than Donald Trump. And what we're seeing happen overseas, the United States is not going to be able to survive if something like that happens here. There is a consequence this election if you stay home or if you want to support Donald Trump. Trust me, things are going to get so much worse. Howard, yeah. I appreciate talking with you. Thank you very much for being with us today.
My pleasure, Farron. Thanks.